Right. So I've worked. I spent time on the Carlin Trend. And that was cool. I was talking to an old colleague, and telling him about, you know, from the Carlin days, and showing him our project. And that it was his words. He was like, "This is like the Carlin Trend. Certainly, the geology is different, but in terms of scale and potential resource endowment, this is what, you know, at the end of the day, when you sit back and you see what's developing here, it's very similar. 35 kilometer long strike length on the trend, multiple deposits and prospects. Remember the Carlin Trend, which was company maker, which made companies like Newmont and Barrick, by the way, right? You know, made companies with that. They're still going there today. Initially, you know, they really started in the 60s, you know, it was one of those projects. People ignored it for ages, and then the geologists had ideas, and then they made their first discoveries, and it was off to the races from there. And so we're seeing a very similar, and I think to date, 140 million ounces in total resources are in the Carlin Trend. And you can just see in our resource growth trajectory, you know, every year we've drilled in the last 5 years, we're increasing resources by 1 million ounces, 2 million ounces a year. I mean, now we're not so focused on growing the resource. That's almost the low-hanging fruit. What we're focused on is infill drilling, because it's not just about resource quantity, it's about resource quality. And we're focused on infill drilling and proving up the resources into the measured and indicated categories. But you just see, when you look at the map, the prospects, how widespread they are across the entire trend that we're seeing, that it definitely has the potential, and it's already shaping up that way, to be the Carlin of the North. Or perhaps they'll rename the Carlin Trend in Nevada the Estelle of the South. Perhaps that'll be happening at the end of the day. Who knows, right?
And so, you know, our partner's profitability is probably the number one criteria that we look at. Where does this asset fit on the respective cost curve? So if we're investing into a copper mine, where does that copper mine fit on a cost curve? And we're only interested in assets in the bottom half of that. And so 93 or 94% of our current production comes from assets that are in the bottom half of their respective cost curves. That's the number one criteria for us. You know, obviously there's a lot of other, you know, we pride ourselves because I think we brought ESG into the streaming and royalty space. Way back in 2012, 2013, we were the first of the streaming / royalty companies to start investing into communities around the mine sites. Royalty companies traditionally have just washed their hands of that and left it in the operator's hands. That doesn't make any sense at all. You know, in today's world, we have to ensure that there's good sustainable benefits left with the communities around our mine sites, and we put a lot of effort into that. And so we now co-fund, and we kicked it off, and I hate, you know, I'm proud of the fact that what we've done is actually changed the industry now to where even the traditional royalty companies, the old school traditional royalty companies, are now co-funding community programs to, again, help strengthen social license and make sure that there's good sustainable benefits left for all the impacted stakeholders around these mine sites. And so that's another area that we put a lot of focus on. We really do look at these assets to make sure that, first off, you know, are they being operated the most effectively they can be in terms of making sure there's good sustainable benefits? Are there opportunities for us to help them do better? Is there stuff that we can help guide them forward?
So Miller's is a project out in Tonopah, Nevada, where we own 1,200 acres outright, pre-permitted land. Former Senator Harry Reid wrote up, there's 17 of these into legislation. I might be off by a number or two, but I would say about 17. And what makes our site so valuable, they've been deemed solar energy zones, is that we have both a power substation on the property and the only available water rights, I want to say within a 15-mile radius. And so when you think about all of the land that surrounds the Tonopah or the Miller site, there's probably about 16,000 acres of BLM land. And so the opportunity to get started on what we control outright and having a project of critical mass or land of critical mass that we can expand into is substantial. And so where we currently are with Miller's right now is we have made the decision. There's been a number of acquisitions that we have been looking at, but we have made the decision to focus specifically on Miller's to get started. We have a number of assessments that have been done to value out the assets that are in the tailings on that property.
And so for a company like ours that is extremely well funded, we've got a great team behind us, we've got the right technology, the right methods, we can come in and we can move very quickly. That was our plan when we first came into Zimbabwe. And what we've achieved over the last 10 months, our team has really moved mountains. They've done fantastically well. And so we're looking to try and bring these discoveries through to production as quickly as we can. So in Zimbabwe, there are 22 Archean greenstone belts. Now, the Archean rocks are some of the oldest rocks that are at surface in the world. They're between 2 to 2.5 billion years old. And because of their age, it means that over that time, over the eons of time, they've been through a lot of geological processes. So this is why you can find so many metal and mineral deposits in these much older rocks that are near surface. Now, it's these same Archean greenstone belts that you also see in Western Australia that gave birth to the bulk mining boom that I just mentioned. What we've decided in Kavango is to focus on one of these greenstone belts down in Matabeleland in the south of the country. And what we're doing is we're building a portfolio of individual projects looking to develop what we believe ultimately could become a world-class gold camp. So ultimately, we would love to discover 10 million ounces that can be brought into mining by piecing together a series of projects over this one greenstone belt that we're focusing on. So it's a very clearly defined strategy. We're concentrating our focus and our operational effort. One of the challenges in Zimbabwe is because there is so much opportunity down there, it could be very easy to be pulled in lots of different directions, chasing sort of new and exciting projects. But by focusing on this one area, we believe we've got an opportunity to build, ultimately, we hope, what will become a tier one gold asset.
As a result, most manganese mines and even ferromanganese plants and steel plants have a briquetting plant. So they'll turn those, a lot of times, they'll turn those fines into like a charcoal briquette size material, and then they put that into the furnace. That's kind of the manganese ore market. And then from there, all those high grade manganese products, there's high purity electrolytic manganese dioxide. So you use a manganese ore, you put it through electrolysis, and it comes out the other end, and that's the stuff that goes into what I call flashlight batteries. There's high purity electrolytic manganese metal, and that's exactly what it's talking about. They're creating electrolytic metal, and that metal can go into the steel sector. It can also go into the battery sector, and it just gets dissolved in sulfuric acid, and you've got your HPMSM. From a supply chain perspective, China controls probably 95 plus percent of the metal market. There's only two metal producers outside of China that I'm aware of. And so therefore the Chinese really control what pricing is going to be from that perspective. And then you start getting into agricultural purposes of manganese. So there's agricultural grade manganese sulfate monohydrate, which is used in a fertilizer. And then if you've ever walked by your town's wastewater treatment plant, sometimes it smells, sometimes it doesn't smell so bad, and that's because they're using permanganate.
This is an industry that's growing very quickly. So you're looking at 20, 30% growth per annum, which is unheard of in our sector. And so the lithium sector was one which was very small. There were relatively small uses if you go back 10 years ago, and it's grown tremendously and it needs to grow a lot more quickly. Which comes back to you in these circumstances, you really want a project that is grounded there at the bottom end of the price curve, so you can survive any scenario. And Ewoyaa has those characteristics. So if there was another implosion in the price, we'd be one of the last mines to close for sure, because everybody else would go bust before us. Not that I'm expecting that to happen, to be frank. As we sit today, if you look at where we are in terms of what's available in terms of supply and new supply, come 2026, when our plant will come on stream, this will actually be a key period for the industry. And it's very difficult to bring mines on quickly, and I think people find it very hard to get their minds around this. We often talk about it taking 10 years to get a mine to production, but the reality is statistics suggest it's more like 15.
And in particular, state level, very supportive of our project as well. They certainly see us as a, I think, a project that is worth supporting with the way we do things. We're very keen to do things correctly from the start and get the correct permits in place and the proper mining license in place as well. Relatively low labor costs in Brazil, high labor availability. I mean, Brazil's power grid is almost 80% renewables and relatively low cost compared to other countries. I did give you a comparison. My last time in West Africa, we were looking at about 19, 20 cents per kilowatt hour for power. In Brazil, we've used 8 for our pre-feasibility study, 8 cents, so half the price of my experience in West Africa. And I think Tocantins Zinia G Mining's operation has just got a contract for 7.5, I think. So very good pricing for power, very supportive local community, as I said. And the macroeconomic climate is very favorable. Inflation, which was around 4.6 when COVID started, is back to pre-COVID levels of about 4.2. So it's a very good environment to work in.
I'm hugely bullish about copper. And given that we were doing gold in Argentina and the project in Chile was copper and gold, and there were other copper targets as well there, then it was just like, oh, this is the perfect mix. It's kind of gold and copper.
And obviously, talking about gold and copper, what are your thoughts, obviously, on the prices of both? Obviously, gold at its all-time high, there or thereabouts, and obviously, copper now starting to make that move.
Yeah, I mean, gold at an all-time high, or you can phrase it in another way, is that the dollar's at an all-time low in terms of its value. There's been so much printing or creation of new money, kind of the money supply has grown so much, kind of global debt is at such a high level, or kind of, US debt. When you look at any currency, money is a matter of functions for a medium, a measure, a standard, and a store. You know, it's an old ditty. And what the paper money has been brilliant at, has been brilliant as being a measure and a medium and a standard. But what it's been terrible at is a store of value. And gold is the ultimate money. It may not be as fungible in kind of day-to-day terms as US dollars or any other kind of cash, but it holds its value. And that is why the gold price is at an all-time high in dollar terms. And it's why I think it's going to continue to run. I don't see this as kind of a temporary blip. So that's hugely exciting for gold.
Something that we didn't really understand at the beginning when we looked at the project, at the front of it, we found that, various different ways, the big recyclers in the business generally take all the electronic waste, they toss it into a furnace and burn it. We didn't want to do that because of emissions and permitting. You know, then we'd be stuck with 2 years of permitting because, you're sending stuff up the stack. So I looked, based on my mining experience, I looked at other ways to process this. And number one, we're dealing with predominantly printed circuit boards. So we'll put them into a processing, shredding, grinding, secondary grinding, third grinding, and then an air separation, whereby we separate the plastics and we take out the metal concentrate. And from the metal concentrate, we'll run it through a refining business, a refining process, and that is take out the copper. So we'll produce a copper 999 copper ingot, and then we'll take it and we'll refine out the gold and then the silver, and then the third process to take the platinum, palladium, and tin.